Professor Foucault and his collaborators, and I'm going to talk about an improved definition of Kuranishi spaces, which is in this paper by me on the archive in 2014. And Kuranishi spaces really started with the work of Kuranishi. So back in 1962, Kuranishi proved that if you have a compact complex manifold X, and you're interested in the moduli space M of complex structures on X, then you can make a small open patch of this moduli space M near a given complex structure J. Roughly speaking, you write M as a zeros phi inverse of zero of a holomorphic map phi going from U into a complex vector space. This is the second sheaf cohomology of the tangent bundle of X regarded, well, the sheaf of holomorphic sections of that. U is an open neighborhood of zero in the first sheaf cohomology of Tx. So we regard H1 of Tx as a space of infinitesimal deformations, or the tangent space. The H2 of Tx is a space of obstructions. Now, what I didn't say is that if X and J has an automorphism group, then really you should be dividing phi inverse of zero by that automorphism group. And in this, the zeroth cohomology group, H0 of Tx, is the Lie algebra of this automorphism group, which you should divide by. So we have a kind of characteristic thing in deformation theory that we tend to get some cohomology theory, and H0, H1, and H2 appear in the deformation theory story, with H0 is the Lie algebra of automorphisms, H1 is the deformations, and then H2 is the obstructions. So as far as I know, this is the first major result on deformation theory in the presence of obstructions, but I'm not really a mathematical historian, so maybe others. But later on, it turned out that many other deformation theory problems in real and complex geometry have the same basic structure identified by Kuranishi. And broadly speaking, whenever you're looking at a moduli space of solutions of a nonlinear elliptic equation on a compact manifold, then you expect its deformation theory to have this general form. Okay. Now, Kuranishi spaces were first introduced by Fukaya and Ono in their paper on Gromov-Witten invariants in the journal Topology in 1999, and then later used much more extensively in their work on Lagrangian Fuller theory in 2008, and a lot of the stuff they've done since. So Kuranishi spaces are a geometric structure which is intended to capture the geometric structure on moduli spaces of pseudo-holomorphic curves, M, let's say GK, J beta, in symplectic geometry. So J is the almost complex structure, beta is the homology class of the curve, G is a genus, K is a number of mark points, and so on. So their idea was that at each point in this moduli space, the Kuranishi deformation theory gives you a local model for this, this moduli space, which you call a Kuranishi neighborhood. I'll explain shortly. And then the Kuranishi space is a kind of atlas of charts definition in which you have a family of charts, Kuranishi neighborhoods covering the moduli space, and you have to glue the Kuranishi neighborhoods together in some way. And really, the entirety of this talk is about the question, how do you glue together two Kuranishi neighborhoods in the right way? Okay. So the goal of Professor Fukaya and his collaborators, I think, was mainly to define virtual cycles of virtual chains for the modular spaces in homology, or to be able to integrate cohomology classes on them and get numbers, which would be your Gromov-Witten invariants. And then having defined the virtual cycles, you could define Gromov-Witten invariants, Lagrangian Fleur theory, and so on. The whole machinery of symplectic geometry involving in theories which involve counting J-homology curves. Okay, and their definition of Kuranishi space worked fine for what they wanted to use it for. But at least to my mind, their notion of Kuranishi space wasn't very satisfactory if you want to think about Kuranishi spaces as geometric spaces in their own right. So I'm wanting to think about Kuranishi spaces as being something a bit like schemes in algebraic geometry, for example. But in the Fukaya-Ota-Ono theory of Kuranishi spaces, for reasons I will talk about later, there isn't really any very good notion of a morphism, F going from X into Y, between two Kuranishi spaces, or even of when two Kuranishi spaces are isomorphic. What they do have is a good notion of a smooth map F from a Kuranishi space X into a manifold Y. Okay, so you would like, and well, there are symplectic geometry applications, in which you would like a notion of morphism between Kuranishi spaces. For example, there are lots of forgetful maps between moduli spaces, where you take a moduli space of curves with k mark points, and you forget one of the mark points, and then that should give you a morphism from the k marked point moduli space, the k minus one mark point moduli space, and morphisms between Kuranishi spaces should be responsible for various kind of more subtle algebraic structures in Lagrangian Fleur theory, in Fukaya categories, and the like. Also, one would like to make sense of the notion of fiber product of Kuranishi spaces, because in fact, fiber products of Kuranishi spaces, at least over manifolds, come up all the time in symplectic geometry. And it would be nice if these fiber products actually had a category theoretic meaning. And also, because I would argue that Kuranishi spaces as geometric spaces are interesting for their own sake. So, well, Kuranishi spaces, you should think of them as a differential geometric analog of schemes in algebraic geometry. In fact, I'm going to claim that they are really analogs of derived schemes in the sense of derived algebraic geometry. And I'm going to explain an alternative definition of Kuranishi spaces, an alternative to the original Fukaya definition. My notion of Kuranishi space forms a two-category, with well-behaved one morphisms between Kuranishi spaces and then two morphisms between the one morphisms. Okay, so Professor Fukaya's definition of Kuranishi space X is an underlying topological space X equipped with a kind of atlas of charts, rather like the definition of manifolds, in which you take a topological space and an atlas of charts, and then you compare the charts with transition functions. So the charts in the Fukaya's definition, which are called Kuranishi neighborhoods, are a quintuple V, E, gamma, S, psi. So here, V is a manifold. E over V is a vector bundle. So you could potentially take this to be a trivial vector bundle, and then that will just be the product of V with a vector space. Gamma is some finite group acting on V and E. S is a section of the vector bundle E over V, which is equivariant with respect to the action of this finite group gamma. And then finally, psi, mapping S inverse of zero mod gamma into X, is a homeomorphism of this quotient topological space with an open set, the image of psi contained in X. So in the Kuranishi deformation theory, which I started with, you should think about V as being an open set in the tangent space, the deformation space, H1. E is the trivial vector bundle with fiber H2. And then S is this map phi going from an open set in H1 into H2, the Kuranishi map. So to do symplectic geometry, you want to allow your J-Hellman curves to have finite automorphism groups, and then gamma it will be the automorphism group of a curve acting.
Professor Joyce, can you hear us? We cannot hear you.
Okay. Right, can you hear me again?
Yes. Good. Could you please share your screen again?
Yep. I'm not quite sure what happened, but I think my I think my internet dropped out for a moment. Okay, where were we? Yeah, so in the Foucault definition of Kuranishi space, you have two of these Kuranishi neighborhoods, and then on the overlap between them in the topological space X, you want to be able to have some kind of transition function between them. So Foucault's notion involved the choice. So if you have one Kuranishi neighborhood VI, second Kuranishi neighborhood VJ, Foucault's notion involves choosing an open subset Vij in a manifold Vi, then choosing an embedding of submanifolds of Vij into the target manifold Vj, and then covering that, you want an embedding of the vector bundle Ei restricted to the open set Vij, mapping to the target vector bundle Ej. So because these involve embeddings of submanifolds, coordinate changes can only make sense if the dimension of the first manifold Vi is less than or equal to the dimension of the second one. So then generally they can only map in one direction. If dimension of Vj is bigger than dimension of Vi, then there are no coordinate changes in the opposite direction. Foucault also requires coordinate changes to be strictly associative on the triple overlaps between three coordinate changes, namely they must satisfy phi j, k composes phi ij is phi ik. Okay, so my notion of coordinate change between Kuranishi neighborhoods is weaker. I only require my maps phi ij and phi hat ij to be smooth maps of manifolds, not embeddings. And I introduce a notion of two morphism or two isomorphism, lambda, between two coordinate changes. And these make Kuranishi neighborhoods into a two category or a kind of sheaf of two categories on the topological space. Then coordinate changes only have to be associative up to two isomorphisms. So I don't require that phi jk composes phi ij is equal to phi ik, but only that there exists a two isomorphism lambda ijk between the two. And coordinate changes phi ij don't have to be strictly invertible. They need only be, well, equivalences in the two category. So invertible up to two isomorphisms. That is, there should exist a coordinate change phi ji in the opposite direction such that the two compositions phi ij and phi ji should be two isomorphic to identities rather than equal to identities. So we just move everything up one categorical level and work with two categories rather than one categories, two categories of charts, really. Okay, so where these ideas really came from was from derived algebraic geometry. In the sense of Jacob Lurie, Bertrand Tern, and Gabriele Bezzozzi. So I claim that we should understand Kuranishi spaces as being derived smooth orbifolds, where derived is in the sense of derived algebraic geometry. So derived spaces are typically, they have a kind of geometric structure, which is an enhanced version of the structure you see on classical spaces. So you have derived schemes and classical schemes, and derived schemes have a richer geometric structure, a geometric structure which remembers about obstructions as well as about deformations, broadly. Okay, so there have been various definitions of derived smooth manifolds, which these definitions, derived manifolds form infinity categories or two categories, but always a higher category. So the first definitions of derived smooth manifolds were written in the language of infinity categories. They are modeled on the definition of derived schemes. So it began really in Jacob Lurie's 2009 paper on derived algebraic geometry 5. The final paragraph of that gave a sketch on how you could use his huge derived algebraic geometry machine to define a notion of derived smooth manifolds. He then gave that idea to his PhD student, David Spivak, who defined an infinity category of derived smooth manifolds by this technique. Now, the problem with Spivak's definition of derived manifolds is that it's very complicated, lives in the world of infinity categories, and for me, at least, I found it almost impossible to get any kind of geometric intuition for what these things really are. But anyway, I think in those days there was rather little crossover between people interested in derived algebraic geometry and people interested in symplectic geometry and the Foucault theory. And I was somebody who was interested in both. And when I read David Spivak's thesis, I had a revelation. I realized that Professor Foucault's Kuranishi spaces were really smooth, derived smooth orbifolds, and that Spivak and Professor Foucault were trying to essentially do the same thing. I then decided it was my mission to try and simplify the definition of derived manifold and derived orbifold in order to make it simple enough that symplectic geometers would be happy to use it, because symplectic geometers don't really do complicated. So my first attempt was to reduce the infinity category definition of Spivak down to an ordinary two category. I defined two categories of D manifolds and D orbifolds. So these are topological spaces with, well, an infinity sheaf or a two sheaf of what are called derived C infinity rings. This is really essentially a kind of a scheme in the world of two categories or infinity categories, but then happening a scheme in smooth functions rather than a scheme in algebras. Now, my definition of Kuranishi space is basically an atlas of charts definition, but it's deliberately constructed to give a two category of Kuranishi spaces, which are equivalent to my two category of D orbifolds. Sorry, can I ask if I'm still connected? Working? Yeah. Okay. So one lesson from derived algebraic geometry is that you really have to work in a higher category, either an infinity category or a two category. In fact, almost all of derived algebraic geometry happens in the world of infinity categories. And that's basically because truncating to ordinary categories loses too much information for reasons we'll see later. Okay, so Professor Fukaya's notion of Kuranishi space actually predates derived algebraic geometry. So one reason for the problems with the original definition of Kuranishi space is that some essential ideas from derived algebraic geometry were missing, especially the higher categorical theory. But you could argue that Professor Fukaya was one of the originators of derived algebraic geometry. Sorry, I'm still a bit worried as to whether I'm connected or not. Is that okay? Good. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so now let me tell you about a kind of easier version of Kuranishi spaces, which I call mu Kuranishi spaces. It's a manifold version of the construction rather than orbifold version of the construction, and they form an ordinary category rather than a two category. Okay, so, and these things, they're rather similar to Kuranishi spaces, but we miss out the finite groups gamma. So let's take X be a topological space. Then we say a mu Kuranishi neighborhood on X is a quadruple V, E, S, Psi, such that, V is a smooth manifold. E is a vector bundle over V, called the obstruction bundle. And S is a smooth section of E called the Kuranishi section. And finally, Psi is a homeomorphism from the zero set of S in V, which could be a rather horrible topological space, to some open subset, the image of Psi in X, where the image of Psi is called the footprint of the neighborhood. Okay. Next, I want to define a notion of a morphism of Kuranishi neighborhoods. And I'm going to define the notion of a morphism over a continuous map of topological spaces. Then the correct notion of transition function between two Kuranishi neighborhoods is going to be a morphism of Kuranishi neighborhoods over the identity map on X. Okay, so let's take V, E, F, Psi to be a Kuranishi neighborhood on the domain X, W, F, T, Chi to be a mu Kuranishi neighborhood on the target Y. Now, we can only define a morphism on the open subset of X in which the Kuranishi neighborhood V is defined and the pre-image of Kuranishi neighborhood W is defined. So let's take S to be an open subset of the intersection of the footprint of V and the pullback of the footprint of W. Let's now consider triples Vij, Fij, F hat ij, satisfying, well, firstly, that Vij is an open neighborhood of S in Vi. Secondly, Fij is a smooth map from our open set Vij into W. And then F hat ij is a morphism of the vector bundles Ei and Fj, or the pullback of Fj, which lives over this morphism F. I want compatibility between the sections S and T of our two Kuranishi neighborhoods. I want the pullback of T to be equal to the image of S under this vector bundle morphism up to order of Si squared. That is, the difference between these two things can be written as Si squared composed with some linear map from the tensor of two copies of E to the pullback of F. Okay, then we define an equivalence relation, twiddle, between two such triples. If there is some open neighborhood V dot IJ in the intersection of your two open neighborhoods, V and V primed. And so this is the tricky bit. I want a vector bundle morphism big lambda going from the vector bundle E on this small open set V dot into the pullback under F of the tangent bundle of W, such that F primed is F plus lambda dotted with the domain section S plus this thing. So if you can compose these two things, you get a vector field on, you kind of get a vector field on W, or you get a section of the pullback of TW on to M. So this is basically a kind of infinitesimal deformation of F. We want F prime to differ by F from this infinitesimal deformation up to the order of the section squared. And similarly, we want the two maps on vector bundles to differ by lambda composed with the derivative of the section T plus order of S. So these equations do actually make sense. They kind of make more sense if you think of them scheme theoretically, really, because you're sort of working on the subscheme of your manifold V, where you divide by the ideal of S squared. Okay, so then we write, this is an equivalence relation. We write the square brackets V, F, F hat for the equivalence class of the triple V, F, F hat. We call that a morphism over set S and the continuous function F. Okay, so because this equivalence relation involves taking an arbitrarily small open neighborhood of this thing, this is really some kind of a germ. It's an equivalence class of germs. So this thing lives arbitrarily close to the zero set inside V. Okay, so the equivalence relation twiddle involving this vector bundle morphism lambda is a strange thing, which is difficult to explain, but it was crucial for what happens later. Okay, so if we're given continuous maps V going from X into Y and G going from Y into Z and suitable open sets and morphisms from U to V over F and a morphism from V to W over G, then there's an actual notion of composition where, well, you essentially take the intersection of the open sets, you compose the various things, you compose the, you compose the maps, you compose the morphisms of vector bundles in the most obvious way, and you get morphisms of from the first to the third Kuranishi neighborhood over G composes F. Okay, so an important property of this notion of morphism between Kuranishi neighborhoods is that it forms a sheaf. Okay, this is not an obvious thing. Okay, but if we have two Kuranishi neighborhoods on X and Y and a continuous map between them, then the morphisms from the V neighborhood to the W neighborhood over our function F form a sheaf on the open set, the maximum open set where they can be defined. So this sheaf property is essential for defining compositions of morphisms of Kuranishi spaces. And we'll see later why that is. And the fact that coordinate changes in the Foucaille theory do not form a sheaf is basically why Foucaille Kuranishi spaces are not a category. Because when you want to compose morphisms, or even define morphisms, you find yourself needing to use a sheaf property to glue together morphisms of Kuranishi neighborhoods, transition functions of Kuranishi neighborhoods. And so this sheaf property is an important thing. Okay, next let's talk about coordinate changes between new Kuranishi neighborhoods. So we take y to be x and f to be the identity, then a morphism between two Kuranishi neighborhoods on x over the identity is called a coordinate change if it has an inverse. That is, if there is an inverse morphism which compose in both directions the identity maps. Okay, so because of my weird notion of equivalence, this does not require that the smooth maps phi ji and phi ij should be inverse, nor that the vector bundle morphisms phi hat ji and phi hat ij should be inverse, but only that phi ji composed with phi ij is the identity plus some lambda dotted with si plus order of si squared, where lambda is an appropriate vector bundle morphism, and the same thing for the phi hats. So let's say dimension of V was less than dimension of VI was less than dimension of VJ, then this would be mapping to a submanifold. This maps the whole manifold, but nonetheless, we can find a lambda to kind of make up the difference between them. So coordinate changes can exist even if the dimensions of the two sides are different. Okay, and there's a theorem which enables us to identify when a morphism between two Kuranishi neighborhoods is a coordinate change. So it turns out this is true if and only if, whenever you have a point X in S, well, that's in the domain of the coordinate change, and VI is a pullback of X to VI, little VJ is a pullback of X to big VJ, then we want the following sequence of vector spaces to be exact. So we're going from the tangent space VI to big VI into the fiber, VI into VI into the tangent space to VJ into EJ. And that's a nice thing you can verify. Incidentally, exactness of this implies that the dimension of VI minus the rank of VI equals the dimension of VJ minus the rank of EJ. And those differences in dimensions are the virtual dimension of your Kuranishi space. Okay, so now I can define new Kuranishi spaces. So let's take X to be a Hausdorff second countable topological space, an N an integer, then a mu Kuranishi structure K on X, the virtual dimension N is a collection of the data. Firstly, you want an indexing set, big I. Then I want a collection of Kuranishi neighborhoods, mu Kuranishi neighborhoods, V, E, S, psi, indexed by little I and big I. And finally, I want a coordinate change, phi ij. So phi ij is a coordinate change between the VI neighborhood and the VJ neighborhood over the largest possible open set, the intersection of the footprints. And these satisfy the obvious conditions. Firstly, the union of the footprints is the whole of X, so the charts cover the whole of X. The change from VI to itself is the identity change. And the coordinate change is composed in the obvious way over the intersection of three neighborhoods. And the dimension N is going to be the dimension of each VI minus the rank of VI. So then we call X a mu Kuranishi space with virtual dimension N. This virtual dimension can be any integer, doesn't have to be positive. We can also define morphisms between Kuranishi spaces. So I'm afraid we're going to get a lot of slides looking rather like this with indices all over the place. But in fact, this is saying something fairly obvious. A morphism is a continuous map, F going from X into Y, and then a morphism of Kuranishi neighborhoods from the VI Kuranishi neighborhood the WJ Kuranishi neighborhoods for all I here and J here, defined over the maximum open set of the footprint of VI and set the pullback of the footprint of the WJ. And these morphisms of Kuranishi neighborhoods satisfy the obvious condition that, well, they have to be compatible with composition of coordinate changes on X over the maximum open set that's possible. And they have to be compatible with composition of coordinate changes on Y, again, over the maximum open set that's possible. So this really is a definition you get if you just follow your nose and write down the obvious notion of morphism once you have some kind of families of charts and morphisms between charts for which are ordinary categories in the obvious way. So if Y is X, you have an identity morphism. And okay, now something interesting now happens when we try to define the composition of morphisms of new Kuranishi spaces. So let's take three mu Kuranishi spaces X and Y and Z with their structures here. Let's take F going from X into Y and G going from Y into Z to be morphisms of Kuranishi spaces. So the question is, how should we define the composition G composes F going from X into, sorry, that should be a Z, not a Y. Okay, well, for each I in the indexing set for X and K in the indexing set for Z, G composed with F has to contain a morphism G of F IK going from, well, the U Kuranishi neighborhood to the W Kuranishi neighborhood on X and Z. This has to be defined over SIK, which is the open set for I, intersect the pullback, the open set for K. So we want a morphism defined over the entire open neighborhood here. Now, at the moment, we haven't got this. Instead, for each little j in the indexing big set, big J for Y, we have a composition GJK composes FIJ, which is defined over a smaller open set, SIJK. So instead of the intersection of two neighborhoods, this is defined over the intersection of three neighborhoods, including this psi j one. Okay, so what we want is a composition, a morphism of Kuranishi neighborhoods defined over a big Kuranishi neighborhood. Instead, for all little j, we have a composition defined over these smaller neighborhoods. And the SIJK for all little j, big J, are an open cover of this SIJK, SIK. Okay, so the solution is that we use a sheaf property of morphisms. So these sets SIJK for all J and big J form an open cover of the domain SIK, which you want. And using the definitions of morphisms, we can show that GJK composes FIJ is equal to DJ prime K composes FIJ primed on the intersection of their domains. So therefore, because morphisms of Kuranishi neighborhoods over G composes F form a sheaf, there is a unique morphism G of F IK defined on the maximal domain SIK, which restricts for each J to the composition GJK composes FIJ. Then you can show that this bold G composes F is now a morphism from X into Z of Kuranishi spaces, and we call that composition. So composition is associative, and it makes these mu Kuranishi spaces into an ordinary category, mu Kerr. Okay, next I want to upgrade all of this up to two categories. So two categories, C. It has objects X and Y, one morphisms, F and G going between X and Y, as for an ordinary category, but it also has two morphisms, eta going from F into G or you write two morphisms with a double arrow, one morphism with a single arrow. So the two morphisms are really morphisms between morphisms. So a couple of examples to have in mind. Firstly, the two category of cat of all categories has objects, which are categories, one morphisms, which are functors between categories, and two morphisms are natural transformations between functors. A second example of a two category would be topological spaces up to homotopy. So here the objects are topological spaces, X and Y. The one morphisms would be continuous maps between topological spaces. Now there's a notion of two morphism, actually two isomorphisms between these one morphisms would be isotopy classes of homotopies H from a continuous map F to a continuous map G. Okay, and there are many other examples of two categories. So in two category, we have three kinds of composition. Firstly, composition of one morphisms as in an ordinary category, but then there's two kinds of composition of two morphisms, which are nicely written in a diagram like this. If you've got spaces X and Y and three, one morphism F and G and H going from X into Y, and then two morphisms eta going from F to G, zeta going from G to H. Vertical composition gives you something mapping from F to H. There's also horizontal composition where if we're composing morphisms from X to Y and from Y to Z, then you can compose two morphisms between them looking like that. There's identity one morphisms and identity two morphisms. Two isomorphisms are two morphisms which are invertible under this notion of vertical composition. Okay, so now let's talk about Kuranishi neighborhoods. So if X is a topological space, now a Kuranishi neighborhood on X is a quintuple of a smooth manifold V, a vector bundle E over V, a finite group gamma, which acts on V and on E, and then a section V, S from V into E, which is equivariant under the Gamba action, called the Kuranishi section. Then the zeros, S inverse of zero, is a topological subspace of V, is invariant under the action of gamma. So we can take its quotient topological space, S inverse of zero over gamma. Psi is homeomorphism from this quotient topological space into an open set in X. And these are the same as the Fukaya Ota Ono notion of Kuranishi neighborhoods. Next, let's take F going from X into Y to be a continuous map of topological spaces. Let's take two Kuranishi neighborhoods, V and W on X and Y. Then we define one morphisms, phi ij over F, and two morphisms, lambda ij between these guys. So I'm not going to write down the definitions of these. They're rather like the definitions of the they're essentially orbifold versions of the definitions I gave before. So the one morphisms are basically an orbifold version of maps. You take an open neighborhood in Vi and you get a smooth map to Vj, and then you take a morphism of the corresponding vector bundles. The notion of two morphisms, they come from vector bundle morphisms from the E to the pullback of the Tw, and they're really a generalization of the equivalence relation, slightly strange equivalence relation I had in my definition of mu Kuranishi neighborhoods. Okay, let's just take this two category of Kuranishi neighborhoods, where we have Kuranishi neighborhoods and one morphisms and two morphisms between them. Let's take this as a black box for now. So then if y equals x and f is the identity, a morphism phi ij between two Kuranishi neighborhoods is called a coordinate change. If it's invertible up to two isomorphism, that is, if it's an equivalence in the two category of Kuranishi neighborhoods. So there has to exist a two morphism going from VJ to VI, and then two isomorphisms going from between the two compositions of phi ij and phi ji to the identity one morphisms. Okay, so with these definitions, which I haven't properly explained, it turns out that Kuranishi neighborhoods have a sheaf property. But this is now a sheaf in the world of two categories, not a sheaf in the world of ordinary categories. So it turns out that if you take, let's take some fixed Kuranishi neighborhoods V and W on X and Y, a fixed continuous map, and then we think about one morphisms between these things defined on suitable open subsets, and then two morphisms between the one morphisms. It turns out that these one and two morphisms form something called a two sheaf, also called a stack, on the open set where these are both defined. What this really means is that they glue well on open covers in a two categorical sense. And in the special case in which Y is X and F is the identity morphism, then coordinate changes form a two subsheaf of the two sheaf of morphisms between these two guys. Okay, so this two sheaf property is again crucial for defining compositions. And this is rather far from obvious, and it depends upon the weird definition of two morphisms, which I haven't written down explicitly. Okay, so now we can define Kuranishi spaces. So don't try and absorb the details of this slide. It is in fact exactly what you write down as a kind of two categorical notion of an atlas of charts. If your charts on your topological space or your manifold form the two category rather than the one category, this is what you do. So a Kuranishi structure K on a topological space X, a dimension N, is a collection of the following data. You have an indexing set. For each index I, you have a Kuranishi neighborhood VI on X. And the difference of dimension of V minus the rank of V is our virtual dimension N. Then for each I and J, we have a coordinate change from the VI neighborhood to the VJ neighborhood defined upon the maximum domain of the intersection of their open sets. And then on each triple intersection, we have a two morphism from the composition of phi ij and phi jk mapping into phi ik. Okay, so for the one category version of an atlas of charts, we have a collection of charts, we have morphisms on double overlaps, and then there's a condition on triple overlaps that morphisms compose associatively. For the two category version of the same thing, we have data on open sets, we have data of transition functions on double overlaps, we have data of two morphisms on triple overlaps, and then we have conditions on quadruple overlaps. So the conditions is that this is essentially an associativity condition for the two morphisms on quadruple overlaps. So lambda IKL composed with lambda IJK is lambda IJL composed with lambda JKL. And again, this is the obvious thing you have to write down in the kind of two category version of an atlas of charts. There's really no choice in the structure of this definition. So then we call X is a pair of the topological space, the Kuranishi structure K, the Kuranishi space of dimension N. Well, we can also define one morphisms between Kuranishi spaces. And again, this is the most obvious definition. We need a continuous map between topological spaces. For each chart VI on X and each chart WJ on Y, we need a morphism from the VI chart to the WJ chart over the maximal domain, which is the intersection of the footprints of the VI, the WJ charts. And then we need some comparison two morphisms. We want to compare the F I prime J composed with the coordinate change on X. So we need two morphisms comparing this composition. So this is for changing charts on X. This one is for changing charts on Y. So the data is these one morphisms and those two morphisms. And then these have to satisfy a bunch of compatibilities on essentially, these are things happening on triple overlaps. They have to satisfy a bunch of compatibilities on quadruple overlaps. And again, this is the only possible definition you could write down. It's just the how to define morphisms in an atlas of charts definition when your charts are forming a two category. Okay, so we can also define two morphisms between one morphisms, and this again is the only possible definition. For each chart VI on X and WJ on Y, you have to have a two morphism between the one morphisms, and then they have to satisfy these compatibilities with the transition functions on X and on Y. Okay, so we can then define composition of one morphism and two morphisms of Kuranishi spaces, identity morphisms and so on, making Kuranishi spaces into a two category. Now, for the mu Kuranishi spaces, we saw that we had to use the sheaf property of morphisms in order to define composition. In this case, we have to use the two sheaf property of one and two morphisms in order to define composition of one morphisms. But this time we have to make arbitrary choices when we do the gluing. Because of this, actually our Kuranishi spaces end up being what's called a weak two category rather than a strict two category, because composition of one morphism is only associative up to two isomorphism. Anyway, so then we end up with a nicely behaved notion of Kuranishi space. Okay, so, well, in your first few weeks studying differential geometry, you define manifolds in terms of an atlas of charts. And you spend a few days playing with charts on manifolds. After that, when you're doing differential geometry, you basically never mention the charts and the atlases again. And it's kind of a bit embarrassing to do that. You get used to saying, well, the manifold is some kind of geometric space. It has tangent spaces, you have smooth maps and so on. But you don't actually use the atlas of charts in any kind of explicit way. So the same kind of thing is possible for Kuranishi spaces. You can start to think about Kuranishi spaces as geometric spaces in their own right and never go back to all of this horrible atlas of the charts again. So Kuranishi spaces include manifolds and orbifolds as full subcategories or full two subcategories. Manifolds live inside orbifolds, live inside Kuranishi spaces. In fact, orbifolds themselves should be defined as a two category, as is well known, in order for their differential geometry to work properly. So lots of differential geometry of manifolds has nice extensions to Kuranishi spaces. So for example, orientations, immersions, submersions, tangent spaces, transversality and transverse fiber products, and so on. If X is a compact and oriented Kuranishi space, it has a virtual class. Well, to a first approximation, it lives in the homology of X over the rationals, in the dimension of virtual dimension of X. Actually, if the topology of X is something horrible, then something I learned from Duzo McDuff is that you have to form the homology class in a slightly weird homology theory called check homology. But if your topological space is nice, for example, if it's a Euclidean neighborhood retract, then you can use ordinary homology, this is still true. There are also versions of Kuranishi spaces with boundary and with corners. Now, an ordinary manifold has tangent spaces. The Kuranishi spaces has both tangent spaces and obstruction spaces at each point. Also, an isotropy group or orbifold group, gx of x. If you've got a Kuranishi chart, then the isotropy group is just a stabilizer of the point in your chart. And there are exact sequences between the tangent space of V, the obstruction space, the same point V, where we map between these by the derivative of the section, and then finally mapping to the obstruction space. And the difference in dimensions of these two is a virtual dimension. Morphisms of Kuranishi spaces induce morphisms of tangent spaces and morphisms of obstruction spaces and morphisms of the finite groups. If one morphisms are too isomorphic, then their action on tangent spaces and obstruction spaces and groups are all the same. Okay, so one theorem is that a Kuranishi space is an orbifold if and only if all the obstruction spaces are zero. A one morphism F from X into Y is a local diffeomorphism, what you might call étale, if and only if the tangent maps and the obstruction maps are isomorphisms and the group maps are isomorphisms for all points X in big X. F is an equivalence, essentially an isomorphism, Kuranishi spaces, if the map is also a bijection. So this basically tells you that the tangent spaces and the obstruction spaces of your Kuranishi spaces tell you almost everything that you want to know about whether two Kuranishi spaces are the same or not. Finally, we have a notion of transversality in fiber products. So for manifolds, if you have smooth maps of manifolds, G from X into Z, and H from Y into Z, they're called transverse if their action on tangent spaces is kind of jointly surjective for all points X and X and Y, which map to the same point in Z. And for transverse maps of manifolds, a fiber product exists in the category of manifolds whose dimension is this. For Kuranishi spaces, there are two derived analogs of transversality. There's a weak notion which says that the obstruction spaces are surjective rather than the tangent spaces are surjective. And there's also a strong notion which says that the tangent spaces are surjective and the obstruction spaces join together to give an isomorphism. In particular, if the target space Z is an orbifold, the obstruction spaces are zero. So this surjectivity here is trivial, and any morphisms G and H into an orbifold are weakly transverse. Okay, so here's a theorem which says that if G and H are weakly transverse one morphisms of Kuranishi spaces, then a fiber product of a Kuranishi space exists in the two category of Kuranishi spaces with the obvious virtual dimension. And this fiber product W is an orbifold. It lives in the subcategory of orbifolds inside Kuranishi spaces, if and only if G and H are strongly transverse. And you can also identify the tangent space and the obstruction space to W by this long exact sequence of the tangent spaces of X and Y and Z and their obstruction spaces. And in fact, so the definition, the transversality map is simply the surjectivity here, the weak transversality condition. And to define fiber products in two category, you really need the two morphisms to define fiber products. And the theorem would be false in ordinary categories. So this is an example of somewhere where we need the higher category structure to get a theorem. Fiber products over manifolds or orbifolds Z always exist in the two category of Kuranishi spaces. Okay, so thank you. That's all I've got to say.
Any questions or comments?
Hello. Am I audible?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, thank you for the talk, Professor. These definitions, you said they are inspired by derived algebraic geometry. And so you lifted all these from one category to two category statements. What is stopping us from doing this in like even higher categories, like three or maybe even infinity categories?
Well, you could. I was trying to make it as simple as possible. So as I said, the original definitions are of derived manifolds happening in infinity categories. My two category is a kind of truncation of Spivak's infinity category of derived manifolds in two ways. Firstly, I've truncated it to a two category. And then secondly, I've forced my two morphisms to be linear in that the two morphisms between a one morphism to itself form a real vector space. And basically, if you impose those two conditions, my Kuranishi space will be a kind of a universal solution to that problem. But there are, as you say, kind of higher categories of derived manifolds, derived orbifolds. It is rather difficult to make sense of the notion of the higher morphisms to kind of explain what they mean geometrically. And well, in a sense, this theorem here is evidence that the two categories are enough, because two category fiber products give you the correct answer for fiber products of Kuranishi spaces. So in that sense, we haven't really lost anything by truncating from an infinity category.